Live from Las Vegas, it's theCUBE. Covering EMC World 2016. Brought to you by EMC. Now, here are your hosts, John Furrier and Dave Vellante.
Okay, welcome back everyone. We are here live in Las Vegas for EMC World 2016. This is SiliconANGLE Media's theCUBE, our flagship program. We go out to the events and extract the signal from the noise. I'm John Furrier, my co-host Dave Vellante. It's our seventh year, theCUBE started in 2010, and we interviewed our next guest during that time, I think every year since, Howard Elias. Welcome back to theCUBE, President and COO of Global Enterprise Services for Dell EMC, and also leading, co-leading the integration between the merger. Howard, great to see you.
Hey,
congratulations.
Great to see you, John, Dave. Thanks, appreciate being back.
It's a big job, it's kind of like a big construction project. You're like the foreman on the job, you got to make sure everything runs in, on time, effectively. I mean, the biggest acquisition in tech history.
It is.
Going down. A lot of conversations, I mean, this what everyone's talking about. So tell us. How's it going? What's the status? Is it going to close on time? What's the stock price going to be? Oh, it's not public.
We'll talk about a lot of things, probably not that.
Going to get edited out by the, you know. Yeah, but on a serious note, big project.
It is.
Two cultures aligned. What's your thoughts on what people are talking about and what would you like to clarify?
Well, let's start at the top. As you said, it's the largest tech combination in history. It'll result in the largest privately controlled integrated IT company on the planet. Pretty exciting stuff. We're part of making history here. It's actually great to see the integration teams have come together very well. And at the highest level, the transaction is on plan, on track, on the original terms, on the original timeline. So when we said back in October, the expected close, we said it would be sometime in Dell's Q2 or Q3, so between May and October, we're right on track. The vast majority of the regulatory approvals have occurred. In fact, there's only a couple of things left to have happen. The SEC will finalize their review of the S-4 registration statement. This is the statement that Dell will use to issue the tracking stock.
Michael mentioned some international things.
China, right?
Well, I was going to get to that, right? So the SEC, just to get the registration statement finalized and the final proxy statement, that needs to happen, and we're very close to that. Then comes the shareholder vote, where the EMC shareholders actually get to vote on it. And then the last of the regulatory approvals is China. We have the vast majority of all the other ones. But everything's tracking exactly as we expected. And then once that happens, the teams will set a closing date.
And so we'll EU's close. Cool?
That's EU's right. Already done, yeah. US is already done, all the other major countries around the world that typically weigh in on something like this. And it all happened completely on track.
How would you compare and contrast this transaction with others you've seen in the industry? Because a lot of people like to, I mean, first of all, people will have opinions on M&A, organic growth versus inorganic. This is a big monster transaction, as you pointed out. What is this like, if any, like anything others, or how isn't it like other big M&A deals?
Yeah.
Certainly you've been involved
in. It's a great question, and you may know, I was actually involved in the DEC Compaq combination, as well as Compaq and HP. I have a lot of experience and battle scars along the way. And look, here's what makes this one very different. First of all, it's larger, but it doesn't actually mean it's more complex. The complementary nature of the product technology portfolio, very complementary, extremely little overlap. There is some overlap in the mid-range and low-end of storage, but if you think about client and server and storage and CI and virtualization and cloud infrastructure and cloud-native apps, no overlap. So that it bodes very well, right? Number two, very complementary customer segments and go-to-market. While we all sell in all markets, EMC's really strong in the large enterprise, large public sector, large telco, large service provider. Dell's strength really lies in mid-market and SMB. Third, the cultures are very, very similar. You heard Michael talk about that at his keynote this morning. And I've seen the microcosm. We're bringing 170,000 people together. Well, we've had several hundred people together now for 6 months, working across 16 teams, building the integration plans, getting ready for day one and beyond when we do full integration. And these teams have really come together as one, very open, constructive, collaborative. We focus on customers, we have a desire to win, we're results oriented, and we act with integrity. And then finally, let's not forget, EMC and Dell had a long-term partnership, 9 years. that at its peak was worth a couple of billion dollars. Michael and Joe know each other very well. The management teams know each other well. And we've demonstrated how we deliver value to customers.
How about the IT piece? It was also announced that you will, after the merger, run IT for the merged company. Huge, you know, task. So congratulations, I think.
Thank
so
you.
So I want to ask you about, like, you just saw HP split apart.
Right.
And actually the IT piece seemed, anyway, from an outsider, to go pretty well. I remember, you guys might remember this, when Sun transitioned from its AMDAL mainframe to its Unix Sun systems, it was like a disaster for three quarters in a row. Is IT just better today? Are there better processes? Is it just more mature? And what have you, you know, learned from observing some of these other, either, you know, mega mergers you talked to once before, but even HP split? Is IT just better? Do we know more about it now?
Yeah, first of all, I will want to say, until the transaction closes, I'm still have my day job here at EMC and co-leading the integration. So yes, post-close, Michael has asked me to look after the overall global services and IT. And look, as we all know in talking with customers, not all IT is created equally. Depends where you've started, what where you are in the journey. You know, the good news, and I've worked with the two teams coming together here, they're of like minds. But, you know, the very interesting thing is, just like the complementary nature of the overall strategic rationale coming together, same thing is true for IT. You know, EMC's IT is really built on a lower volume of very, you know, high value, complex configurations, integrated solutions, converged infrastructure that we deliver. The Dell IT was really purpose-built for very high volume, extremely large number of transactions on a daily, weekly, monthly basis, a lot of attach going on with that, and so we're going to preserve and protect the value that each of us have created, even as we look for ways to bring together common customer, master, you know, common reporting. We're going to be very thoughtful in the approach. And the good news is the IT being agile, flexible, modular, that will allow us to do that.
So they always say people, process, technology. Technology is the easy part. It's
correct.
The people
it's
and
the
process.
People,
so
process.
Is that where you expect to spend your time?
It's exactly where we're spending 100% of our time. People, process, and the operating model. Because the operating model, how you interface with the product teams, how you interface with the business, how you interface with different customers and different customers segments. You know, everybody looks at their, you know, what does it mean to be a trusted advisor to me? Well, if you're a large enterprise or a mid-market customer, it could mean different things.
John and I have been talking a lot about the operating model. It's cloud. Cloud isn't a place to put stuff. It's not a place to put data or apps. It's the operating model.
It's the style of computing.
So how will cloud play into that operating model?
The same way we work with our customers. It'll be a hybrid cloud environment. We'll have you know, private cloud instances for agile, flexible, where the workloads are predictable, and especially for those mission critical applications. We've already started to introduce VirtuStream, even on the EMC IT side, to be able to make the choice whether it's our data center or a different data center. But we'll also utilize SaaS-based offerings, partner-based offerings, and even public clouds for the workloads that make sense.
Mm-hmm. Howard, I got to ask you, because a lot of people talk about M&A and deals like this, like changing an airplane engine out at 35,000 feet. It's very difficult. And so there's a non-disruptive operational kind of mindset or guiding principle. So my first question is, two-part question. One is, what is the guiding principle of the co-team that you're co-leading with your Dell cohort on this? What's the kind of the guiding principle? And what is the hardest areas to work on? Is it sales teams? Is it operations? Is it the product? Is it IT? How do you stack rank the challenges?
It's a great set of questions. Let me start by, we actually did from day one set out those guiding principles. First, it is do no harm. Both companies are great companies in their own right and have created tremendous value for the customers they serve. So protect the value that we both create. You know, Dell with the Dell products and the Dell go-to-market, EMC, same thing. Second, let's make sure we deliver a phenomenal employee experience. The most important thing we can do on day one is have employees feel like they're part of a new company. It's not part of the Dell part of the company or the EMC part
of the company. Unify everybody.
It's, you know, get to everybody to a common vision, a common mission. We understand what we're trying to accomplish. But even simple things like, let's make sure on day one, that employee experience of collaborating, being able to message each other, be able to work together with the tooling is all very important, because if you have great employee experience, then you can focus on the next big thing, which is the customer experience. So we want to make sure the customer gets everything they get today, but then the other thing that we'll do very close to day one is show the power of the combination through new offers. New product offers, new solution offers, new service capability that we're going to be able to deliver. So, you know, that's really the focus we've had, the guiding principle. What are the watch out points? We have got 16 work streams working on go-to-market, services, IT, supply chain, operations, you list them all. The most important thing that Rory Reed, my colleague and I, are focused on is majoring on the majors. Make sure we all understand this is about building that great company, and it's really the five things that we're focused on. It's that employee experience, it's the customer and the partner experience, it's the new capabilities that we're going to show the power of this combination, and then it's the revenue and the cost synergies. Now, every big combination like this is going to have some cost synergies. There's going to be certain areas of duplication and redundancy. But we believe the revenue synergies are going to be at least three times the cost synergies. And frankly, the more time we spent working on this, the more opportunity we see. So it's
everyone's smiling.
Well, but it should be no surprise. Yeah. If you go back to the thesis, complementary products, complementary go-to-market.
I want to ask you a question that's come up in our community. It's a security question, not a technology question. It's sort of a business question. You'll be, I presume the CIO, you're not the CIO, the CIOs will be reporting into
you.
A conversation in our community is, how is the conversation changing between the CIO or CISO and the board? What should the board know about security? How should the CIOs, CISOs be communicating to the board? So if you have to communicate to the board, the new merged company, about security, what should they know?
Yeah, it's a great question. I actually do sit on an outside public board as well, so I have this experience from the other side. And to a board member, it's really part of the risk management framework, right? You have to look at things like reputational risk, operational risk, market-based risk, financial risk, and now cyber risk. So it's part of the overall framework the board has to look after, and both the CIO and the CISO has to be in a position to be able to clearly and articulately explain to the customer, here is the risk profile that we have, and here's what we're doing to mitigate the risk. You can't eliminate all risk, or otherwise you won't do business. But it's understanding the B2B, the B2C parts of your business, it's understanding those attack surfaces, and rolling it up into an overall enterprise risk management framework, and get folks comfortable about where you're going to take the risk and where you're not going to take the risk.
Is there an increasing recognition that it's not a matter of if we get compromised, but when, and then how should we be responding to that? Is that a shift that's occurring?
That shift has happened years ago. There's only two kinds of customers left in the world: those that know they've been compromised and what they're doing about it, and those that don't yet believe or know that they've been compromised. The bad guys are everywhere, and by the way, there's some bad guys inside our companies, right? And so it's, how do you actually manage the risk profile? How do you either think about segmenting your networks, classifying your data? But you know, at the same time, we've all got to do business in an open, collaborative way.
I want to ask you another question. It's VCE related, Acadia related. You started all.
Oh my goodness!
A lot of
people
don't know that, but you incubated. You were the original, sort of on the original team. You led that team to create that. As you look back, I mean, how does it feel? What are your thoughts on what VCE has become? The whole converged infrastructure industry, which you guys, you know, certainly started, or one of the few that were involved early on. What are your thoughts on that?
No, thank you for that. It feels awesome. It's great to see, you know, we started it, my colleague and I, Gary Moore at Cisco, and Rob Lloyd, and a few of us got together and had this great idea. And look, I don't know that we would have described it the way we do today back then, but it actually is the best way of putting a point on what we had in mind. And that is, why would a customer buy, build what they can buy? And so the fact that we're able to integrate a more complete experience around the infrastructure in the data center, where customers can focus at the app level on the people, process, and operating model, and frankly on the digital transformation journey that every customer has to go on. And it's great to see the multiple billions of dollars of results, customers voting with their dollars each and every day. But it's also great to see the expansion of the product line, the expansion of the team, blocks, racks, appliances for more traditional systems of record apps, but also now for systems of engagement and system of insight apps.
Yep.
The new VX Rail is just a home run. And VX Rack for those scale out applications as well. It's just great, and the team has also matured. I know you're going to have Chad on at some point here.
Of course.
He'll do a much better job of explaining the future excitement going on there.
Well, you guys made a good call there, because now the rage is purpose-built and or engineered type systems. Certainly
exactly.
Oracle leading with that, and now you're seeing some of the innovations. It's not about the commodity hardware anymore.
No, it's really about delivering that engineered system.
Yeah.
And customers, I think, are finally over the fact that they don't have to tweak every knob and dial. That, you know, they just want to now buy and implement versus build and focus their dollars and their resources elsewhere.
Howard, thanks so much for coming on theCUBE. I know you're super busy at the integration. I'll give you the final word. What is the, for customers watching and certainly employees of both companies, give a quick soundbite on the vibe of the integration, the plans, et cetera. And share some color on that.
Well, you know, it's great. I'm out with customers all the time. There's been research that have been done as well. The vast, vast majority of customers are looking forward to the combination. We're humbled and pleased to know that most of those customers actually say to us that they believe they will spend more money with the new combined company than they spend individually. And I think it's because they see that value as well. As customers go on their digital journey, as they modernize IT, as they think about the future trends of converged infrastructure, software-defined everything, cloud infrastructure, cloud native, next generation apps, all done in a secure and mobile way. This will be the essential infrastructure company for this new industrial revolution. There will be no better company on the planet that can deliver that integrated solution to customers.
Howard Elias, been there, done that, and now driving the bus on the integration, man on the job. Big task, congratulations, good luck, continued momentum, hope we get closed on time. It looks like it's going to. Thanks for sharing your insights here on theCUBE. Live here at EMC World, I'm John Furrier with Dave Vellante, extracting the signal from the noise. You're watching theCUBE.
It's always fun to come back to theCUBE.